Nicholas Meyer. I have been an iOS developer for the past 7 years. So why am I talking about writing a Mac application in Haskell? So I have Haskell as a hobby since 2006. And actually, if you look at the platform, iOS and Mac, actually it's pretty much the same operating system. It's the same basic libraries. The UI layer on top, that's the little part that's different. So from my experience, writing a Mac application is not so far. And of course, I want to use the best language in the world, which is Haskell. No, this is very cool. What are we going to talk about today? I'll introduce to you the JSON Graph Generator. This is the application I have written. I'll show you how the worlds of OpenC and Haskell fit together. And I'll tell you a little bit about the architecture, how it all plays out in practice, and do a little bit looking back at how it works. So, let's start with the JSON. Let's start with the JSON class generator. What is it? It's a Mac application. It's around 15,000 lines of Haskell code, 3,000 lines of Objective-C code. There's a little star I will explain later. It's on the Mac App Store. You can only also download on web. It's sandboxed, so this is some requirement for Mac applications on the store by Apple. It's some technology that limits apps in various ways. For example, you are not allowed to access arbitrary files on the file system, plus your application cannot do too much bad things. So if you're wondering if you can ship an application on the Mac App Store that requires sandbox, yes, actually it's no problem as long as you use system libraries for accessing files. So you have to present a native open dialog, and then the user selects a file. Your application is granted permission to access this file and do something to it. This is the website of my company. So if you're interested in it, you can have a look. But what's better than a demo? So I'll give you a short demo of the application. So here you see Xcode, and what I want to do is I want to write some application in Objective-C that accesses some service. So I already have a URL here. It's for fetching super funny jokes with Chuck Norris. So let's just write the code for fetching. You'll put the URL, and we'll put the URL, and then we're going to apply something to the result. And we can put some code here. And actually, what this call does, it's also logs the response from the server. So let's just run it and see how it looks. So this is the application. It's pretty basic. It has a label, a text, and a button telling me a joke, which is hooked up to this function here, and which hopefully does some network request. So let's see. Okay, and then we get some JSON, a Chuck Norris joke. It has a rating and a text. And actually, what we would like to do is we want to display it in the label. So let me quickly write the code for setting this in the label. Okay, so this would require for having a joke object. Let me define a joke object. Okay. cluster. Unfortunately, I don't have it yet. And I could now implement some class, which does some parsing of the JSON, but this is all a lot of work. So let's rather use the other tool I wrote, the JSON class generator, for bring over the window. This is it, for defining a class. So we have, this is written in Haskell actually, it's completely native Mac application. You can minimize the window, you have the standard menus with save, close, edit, naming, and all the stuff that comes from the system. You really only have to implement very few functions to get this functionality. But let's define a trickier class here. We can call it joke, and now put in the ID and the rating and the text, and then let's export some code. Okay, so now we have defined our class, and what this will do is generate the Objective-C code for this class along with a bunch of helper methods which are pretty convenient to have. And now let's just export the code. Hopefully it's in the right directory. Yeah, it's already in the right directory. And now we need to import it here. Here you can see the implementation for this class. And if we run the code, hopefully now after importing, well, I already did this, then the text should display in the label. There we go. So this is how easy you can convert the JSON structures to Objective-C classes. Actually, it has more features. You can you can have classes and enums, and actually also you can have server functions for your API. But there's no user interface for it yet. So yeah, that's the application I wrote, just to give you a short impression. And now I want to tell you how I actually wrote it. So it started out as just a simple Haskell file where I defined a data type called type, and it's just something like an enum with values in string and arrays, and then the value is associated by, or in Haskell we call it algebraic data structures. And I could now create values of this type for representing my my classes, and also my functions. Here are some examples. You don't have to read all the details. What it then all did would compile everything together, and there was just the main function which would then write the code that is generated from these structures just into files. So this was a nice start. Unfortunately, my colleagues had to install Haskell, so the idea was, what about a command line utility, which just actually was the next step. So I wrote a command line utility where you could insert, write the specification in JSON. I thought everybody knew JSON who works with this application, so this would be a good language. Actually, it's very tedious to write, and errors can happen simply. By the way, this is how you would run the command line utility. But the generated code is fine. So the next step was, what about putting some user interface on top so that we don't have to edit this JSON, which is annoying. Well, this is the application you have seen. Here you see the work in progress, how you would define the function, the method for the service, get order. And yeah, so obviously the interface here is written in Objective-C, and the core is written in Haskell. The question is, how did I join these two worlds? Well, first I thought, what kind of interface do I want to have? You could have a web interface on top of Haskell. There's a number of good libraries for this. You can use cross-platform UI libraries like GTK. There's a binding process. But with the non-native, there's always some kind of problem because it doesn't fit really well into the world you're in. That's why I decided to use some native user interface, which means that all the safe and open would behave normally, that scrolling speed would be the same. The menus would be on the top on Mac and not in the Windows like you would get with GTK. You could even have a Time Machine backup support for your application just for free because it comes with Apple's frameworks. And you really want to create native on the platform. So this is why I chose native. Then the next question is, then how do I put Haskell and Objective-C together? One option would be keep the command line tool and build just a UI tool for editing the models, giving the JSON description of the service and data structures to the command line tool and exporting the file. But I thought this is not a beautiful way because I would have to invent all the model files again on the Objective-C side and make sure that they match with the Haskell side and so on and so forth. Wouldn't it be better to have an application that's like just one binary and two applications really in one? And then you could have the model in Haskell, which I already have. I only need to add the functions for modifying the model. So this is what I did. The question is then, how would these two components communicate with each other? Well, Haskell has a foreign function interface that goes to C, so we can use C data types for exchange, and also Objective-C is just a superset of C, so we could use this as a basis. But of course, writing all these interface functions makes a lot of work, and there's other people who already wrote libraries like C2HS, which can parse C files in order to generate Haskell code from this. There were also some binding libraries like Haskell Objective-C and Objective Haskell. I think the first one was deprecated 2004. Actually, there's a problem with those binding libraries because they seem to break every time there's a new version of the libraries coming. Also. There's tons of libraries that Apple ships with the operating system, and just keeping it up to date is an enormous amount of work. And a much better way, and unfortunately a way that I was aware much too late of, was language C and line, which allows you with quasi quotes in Haskell to write Objective-C code in the middle of your Haskell code, and then the library will take care of compiling it and marshaling the data types you exchange. So this is a very nice way of binding, and it allows you to not only use the primitive functions from the frameworks, but you can write larger blocks of Objective-C code and then that accomplish something in multiple steps and then just make use of this in one Haskell function. This is really nice. One other drawback I saw is if I ever want to go across cross-platform, like I really would like an architecture that's more separated. And I found things like this Apache Thrift, which can generate code similar to my tool, but much more complete, or more than 15 different languages, I think. And you have then all the data types, you have the service methods, there's all the networking included. But oh wait, if I combine two parts in one application, they don't need a network socket to communicate with each other. They don't even need HTTP to communicate with each other. I can just do it in memory. So this seems to be a little bit overkill. So I thought I need some kind of client-server architecture, and writing the server in Haskell is not so hard, but the main question then was for me, how do I connect Objective-C to a server that speaks JSON? Well, I just wrote a JSON code or class generator that allows me to exactly do this. So actually what I do is I have an interface between the languages is just plain JSON, and all the data structures and methods in Objective-C are just generated. And that's why I put the star in the beginning. It's 3,000 lines of interface code, of user interface related code in Objective-C, and it's 13,000 lines of generated code I don't really care about, because after generation it just works. Next question was then, even with this technology, how would I combine these two languages in one application? Well, fortunately, both are compiled applications, and what you want to do is merge it into one binary. And there's a lot of ways of doing this. And if you look for the tutorials, you can compile Haskell to object files or Objective-C to object files, and then link it on terminal, link it with Xcode, and so on and so forth. There's really a lot of ways to do it, but after a few attempts, the best way seemed to be compiling Haskell into a static library, and then also I need to generate the API for my specification, and then I would just compile the Objective-C source code and storyboards and copy all the frameworks just like normally, and in the end I would link the library I generated from Haskell together with libicon that this library depends on. This is my Haskell code, and I can set up everything in Xcode, and I can use the run button to just run my application. That's really nice. And just to give you a short impression of how long I was searching, these were my attempts to get it to work. But in the end, it didn't work. But now, since it's combined, how do I actually start up the application? I have two runtimes. I need to start the Haskell runtime. I also need to start the Objective-C runtime. And again, there's two ways. I can launch Objective-C first and then start Haskell, or start Haskell first and launch Objective-C. So what I've come up with is the C function. I have just normal C file, and it would initialize the Haskell runtime, and then it would call some so-called main function in Haskell, which actually will check if the first parameter given was CLT, because I still wanted to be able to run this tool as command line tool. And if it's a command line tool, then it would just run the main function of the command line tool, browsing the rest of the arguments, and you would never start up with the user interface. Whereas if no arguments are given, I want to start really the Objective-C runtime, which I do via the FFI. Here is the exported function in Haskell, and here is the original one in the C world. This boots up the runtime. You have to be a little bit careful, because you want to run the Objective-C runtime on a bound thread, because it uses thread local state. Otherwise, you will have very weird effects in your application. I compiled Haskell with minus threaded, which allows re-entrant code. This just means if I do a call from Objective-C to Haskell, and then this goes back to Objective-C again, and then maybe back to Haskell, that this doesn't lead to any problems. So let me tell you the rest of the architecture. Nice picture, I hope. This is how it looks like. It's a typical like Mac application. You have some application delegate. It manages the menu. And then what happens if you select a new document on the menu? Well, actually, the application will create a new instance for your document. It will load it from an interface file. And then it will create a document at window controller, which will create a service layer and the client, and then at the bottom it will create some kind of Haskell server. So what's going on the bottom? I needed to export yet another function, and a foreign function interface, which I call the make passageway. So this is just a C function that will return a pointer to a C function, which takes a string and returns a string. So the string that it takes is my request, that's my JSON serialized just to a pointer of char. The response will be an already marshaled NS data, which is something like byte string in Objective-C. So each time I create a new document, I create this passage, which also creates an instance of the model on the Haskell side and starts serving it. And once my document shall be deallocated, the pointer and all my data is gone on the Haskell side. So to tell you a little bit more about the server, it stores the model. It has synchronized access on the model, so nothing bad can happen. It just serves JSON. We don't need any HTTP, as already said, because it's hardwired through this string copying. The calls are actually blocking. Usually, if you communicate with the server, you do something with the network, and you wait for some time, and then there might be a response or not. But here, the server is always online and has zero latency, and you can get back the results immediately. And you have one instance per document. So, just to show you like the main function of the server, it's I call it process action. So I have some data structure. I call an action, which is what should be done. And I have app, which is the state of my, or which is really my complete model I have invested. And I create two new values from it. The first one is an app again, so it might be modified, it might not be modified. The second one is a value that I pass back to Objective-C. That's my result of the computation. So with this structure, which a little bit looks like state model, I am able to read any values or modify anything in the model just in one step. And all functions on the model I read into this structure. So to give you more impression what's inside the model, well, I did the undo manager on this layer just because it was convenient to just have list of all the states my application has been in, and it's a little bit different than the typical undo manager implemented in Objective-C. There you would have an array of undo steps that you need to record while doing some step, and then if you record something which is not the exact opposite of your first step, then your model becomes corrupted. So it's better to just record every state I've been in, and this is then my undo state, and I just need to do some small modifications to the undo manager from Objective-C in order to just forward all requests to the Haskell side, which knows much better what's going on. For the outline view, that's the part on the left side where I define all the values. So actually, this is just computed from my model state, and I give data structures representing this view to Objective-C, and then on the Objective-C side I render it. I don't generate this whole list every time, I just calculate the diffs on the Haskell side, so what I'm really only sending is updates like insert row, delete row, update row with some new value, or reordering of the rows. Now we come to a small problem I had, because for a hardwired button, I do a specific server call, you could say service call, which would return some value, and it's really hardwired. But for the view on the left, the view is generated dynamically. So I put in completion blocks and Haskell. But then how do I pass the structure to Objective-C and then call the completion block? Well, we could do it through the FFI and export function pointers, but this looked like a lot of hassle. So instead of this, I generate the complete structure with all the callbacks, and then right before leaving the Haskell side and going to the Objective-C side, I pick out all these completions and replace it just by numbers and keep a hash map, and on the Haskell side with the numbers and the completion blocks. So Objective-C ever sees just IDs for callbacks, and then once you press a button, it says, okay, button ID 5 is pressed. It gives this information to the Haskell side, and Haskell does a lookup what completion shall be called, and then it applies this to the model. This gets a little bit more trickier for the menu where you select the types. Actually, you can select something like array, an array of array of array, and you can go like this infinitely long. And what I need to encode there was either it's a terminal, a final selection of the in the menu, which doesn't have a submenu, which then executes some method for updating the model somehow. Or it's something that will show yet another submenu, which is only computed at the time where you hover over the menu item. So in order to do this, I'm making use of continuation passing style. I keep these continuations also in my hash map and execute them, and they might return either a result or the submenu. So some people might worry now about the performance. I mean, I'm inside one application and I'm going back and forth through the JSON isn't just playing it by faster. Yes, probably it's faster. But in practice, it doesn't play a really big role because for the only part that's big, which is the outline view on the left, if you load a large document, it's only when you load it I have to transfer a lot of data. In case of updates, I'm just transferring the diff and just passing around some numbers and IDs through JSON really is hardly noticeable that there's any lag. And then when Haskell really executes something, it's, so for those things I do, it's always pretty fast. So, luckily this construct is, for this kind of application, good in performance. Let's look a little bit on the client side. What does the client do? It actually just powers the generated server layer, service layer. It serializes requests from generic JSON representation to this C string. It does a little bit of memory management. It deserializes the responses. And also logs errors and exceptions that might happen in Haskell. And does something else. It updates a thing I call model revision counter, which is just like the size of my not exactly the size of my undo stack, but like at which step in my undo stack I am in, which means like every number represents a specific state my application is or was in, if you go to the past. I want to talk a little bit more in detail about memory management and logging errors and exceptions, and we'll come back to the model revision counter at some later stage. I just want to mention like where it comes from. So about memory management, really this is not so hard. Objective-C has automatic reference counting, so somehow it's already been taken care of the memory. Haskell has garbage collection, so this is fine. And then we have the problem, what happens if we pass the data between the world? And my strategy really for this was avoidance. So I don't want to really deal with it. I do the following. If I encode a request and send it to Haskell, I use the bracket style. I allocate some C string for my data, which I keep in memory while doing the call to the Haskell side. Since the blocking call, once the call returns, I can just deallocate. So this is pretty easy. And then on the Haskell side, I thought about doing exactly the same. So I pass the data back to Objective-C, and then once Objective-C is done, no, this doesn't work because Objective-C, I don't, Haskell doesn't know what Objective-C at this point is doing. So I use a little trick, I invert it. If Haskell wants to send a response, it allocates a C string, passes this to the Objective-C side. Objective-C marshals it into an NS data, which it keeps track of in its memory management system. And then the Haskell call returns, but it has the pointer address of this NS data. And then when the call returns, it just passes the pointer address to the Objective-C side, which already is dealing with the NS data. So, problem solved. Pardon. Except I had some problem of wasting memory, which I saw in my debugger. And after looking at it for a moment, I noticed my model wasn't really strict, and I was keeping a lot of unevaluated stuff in memory. And after fixing this, my memory consumption went down quite a bit. So the other topic I want to explain short was exception handling. So once an exception happens on the Haskell side, which is likely very rare, I report the error to some tracker, in this case a Hockey app, because all the trackers I know from iOS that we use don't support Mac. Then the question is, what if the Objective-C site, for example, crashes? Well, there's normal mechanisms that you would use. It shows some dialogue, oh, sorry, something happened to your application, please send what happens to me and all the some stack trace. The other question is, what happens if the Haskell crashes? Well, Haskell really just throws an exception, and what I needed to do is just I catch all the exceptions right before the foreign function interface, because it's undefined what happens if you pass the exceptions to the other worlds and never arrive and where we are in some weird state. So I catch everything there, and this is then what goes into the error reporting, which is actually only the exception for testing I used. I reported, but so far I haven't seen anything. I had the problem of some exceptions being lost. And the problem there is with Haskell's laziness, that the part that will produce the exception is not yet evaluated once passing the check for the exception. So I needed to force the evaluation at this point, then check for the exception, instead of passing the stunt to the part that serializes it or would otherwise cause the exception. So this is specific, I think, to Haskell or lazy evaluation, took a moment to figure out. Just to give you a complete picture, here is what the service layer looks like, just the generated methods, which exactly correspond to what we have seen on the Haskell side. You have functions for like what's the menu item, in which state is the menu item. For a certain file, give me the content I want to export. I want to add a class, please add a class, and so on and so forth. It's not super interesting stuff, I think. Let's talk a little bit about the document and the window controller. Well, the window controller, what it does is it uses Reactive Coco with bindings to bind the user interface to the server. So my control there is really, really stupid and just this binding. To give you an impression how this binding looks, so here, for example, maybe I can show it on the application. So here we have some button that will show the open dialog. We can change the export path. And if you look here, we bind to the button path, which I call the button on the bottom. The command just open the file chooser dialog. It's a little bit overhead because I'm using these signals. And if I want to add a class, it's just doing a call to the service layer, please add a class. So this is a very easy setup, which is done on window creation. And for reading, it's quite similar. Maybe the example on the bottom is too long. But at the top, you can see there is that's the text that's on top of this button I was just talking about. So there we again have the model change signal. This is the one, what I said on the slide with the client, that the client keeps track of, like, which is the revision my model is in. So once this revision number changes, we need to update the state of the title of the button, because the user might just have edited the paths and selected the different paths. So all user interface elements are bound this way. So what we just do if we have some new text, we just set it as a title. And if the text is empty string, then we just hide the button at all instead of showing a button with search. Just for completeness. So here is the user interface. For this, you have the interface builder of Xcode for doing it. And here you just do it like with any normal application. You have your variables defined in code, and you just drag and drop to the user interface element. There's nothing different in this for Haskell Mac application than for any other application. So what's really nice here, it was mentioned also today, was the unidirectional data flow. So really all things that happen go the stack down to the model, update the model, which is a pure function. I don't have any I/O there, except then when going to the for function interface. And then this change in the model will update the revision counter, which will cause all the UI elements to update their views. So how does it all play out in practice? Well, there's a number of things. There's like the question, for example, what kind of development tools do you use? Here you use Xcode, you can use Xcode's debugger. I will show in another slide how this will look like if you debug test report with it. So you can basically only use it for the PC. Then the Haskell part I wrote with Haskell for Mac mostly, which is a nice IDE. I use Sublime for some scripts or sometimes. You can use the instruments profiling tools that come with Apple's development tools for looking at the memory and so on and so forth. But again, for the Haskell part, you just see that memory is occupied, but you have not so much improvements going on, only if it grows. But there are fortunately tools for the Haskell side as well, ThreadScope for performance, and you can use the runtime system for looking at the memory. Just to give you an impression how it looks on in Xcode, if you debug something, so here we don't have a crash, but it just set a breakpoint in code. And on the left hand side, you see the nice stack, and you know that that it was caused by some button on the window and went through the service and then we stopped. And here, actually, we have the function that does the marshalling back from the Haskell exported C string from Haskell to NS data. And so it's actually the Haskell side calling this function. And there you just see three, four frames with very cryptic names. And actually, you never have a long stack. So you are you have to use, of course, Haskell's debugging tools. So what will you do for testing? So I wrote unit tests for both Objective-C and Haskell, and they are written in their respective languages. There's nothing special really going on. For user interface tests, I kind of just test the application normally with Apple's user interface test like any other applications. So what's new here with this design is you can use what I would call server interface test. Probably there's a much better name for it. What I mean is instead of really pushing the buttons in the UI, you have available the information from the model through the service, and you can, instead of pushing the button, you can directly call the service method, which means that whereas normal UI tests are pretty slow to run, you can just go a little bit deeper on the level and then run the tests in a very fast speed. One advantage of this architecture. Looking back a little bit, what were my challenges? So first getting started, thinking about how it all takes place together, how they use the building, the setup, the architecture, which parts of the application would be in, written in which roles. This took a moment to figure out also debugging, as we have seen, not trivial. Luckily, nothing really bad happened. And for all problems, really they are solvable, so you just need to, Well, usually for problems, you go to Stack Overflow and look for the solution. If you write this kind of app, actually you have to find the solution probably yourself, because the tutorial stopped at the much earlier level. But it's all really doable. It's no big magic. So I can only encourage you. It's very interesting as well and enlightening. Reflecting on the app a little bit. So Haskell language, obviously I like it a lot. But you can use any other language, of course, as well. That has not foreign function interface and compiles in ways that you can combine it with Objective-C. But when would I really use it? I think I wouldn't start my next application for iOS or Mac just with Haskell. I think it depends a little bit on the problem. And I think for the code generation, Haskell was really nice. I wouldn't want to write this with Objective-C. Maybe with Swift, but Swift wasn't around actually when I started. So you have a certain kind of problem for which you feel a different programming language would be much easier to use, and this would be a good reason. And also for me, cross-platform was a reason, so I wouldn't be able to attach some Windows C-sharp UI or some web interface or something to it. And then really you have to think about which language are supporting a lot of platforms, actually a lot are. I see mostly on the web if people use this, they use C++. For me, Haskell, I think, is a much nicer choice. And for the question, would I go with something that's just cross-platform from the UI layer? From the UI library, I still wouldn't want the application to have a GTK interface on Mac, because all these features that come with the platform, like the system services and so on, are just not supported. So this is a nice way to have most of the compute in Haskell and just a thin layer on top of it is just platform specific, and you can make use of all the features. Yeah. So if you're interested in this topic, where to get started for Objective-C and Haskell in particular, there are some old but good blogs by Jim Shetler. I put the links there. There is, of course, the FFI section of the Haskell 2010 report, which I highly recommend. There are some nice talks about Dropbox, how they wrote Dropbox and other apps across platforms, and C++, but still interesting. There's a good talk about language C inline library. For GitHub and package, which I think is an easier approach than my server approach. If the primary goal is to connect to write a Mac application in Haskell and not to the platform. And also I would suggest to check out the Haskell IDE for Mac, which is really nice and so if you have any questions, please let me know. Most of it actually is Haskell. The Objective-C part might be just megabyte also. Maybe to answer more, it's because everything is statically linked, which you want to do if you want to shift the application.
But what is that? Is the runtime statically linked from the compiler?
All the libraries that I use for Haskell, for example, are statically linked.
What, how do you ship your Haskell source? Is it like in some intermediate format?
I compile it to a library, like just like any other C library, and this is just linked with the application. And at this point, nobody really sees anymore that this is a different, like this library is not written in C or C++, but it's just written in Haskell. The thing is just you need to initialize it differently.
So if you wanted to do the same for the iOS, you would need to compile it to ARM?
Right, you need to compile this library for ARM. There are some projects for it. I had some Haskell iOS application running in 2012, but actually every time I wanted to do the setup with all the tools, it took me like 2 days. And, I hope it's much better.
One last quick question.
So if I don't have a tool to generate the JSON for all my classes,
what do you do? Well, you can get the tool. And the alternative is really language C and Rhyme, which is a super cool library for using Objective-C and test computers. It's like, I think this is C.
Does it allow, so does this approach allow, for example, other mechanisms, power network? Power nap is when you close the match, right? And then it decides, oh, just check it and it fires up.
What you can use, since there's some part written in Objective-C, you can make use of all the tools available that Apple gives you. So Haskell part is just some other thing that's just bundled inside your application also that doesn't limit you anyway.
If you don't have like an example of all this,
I can show you maybe after this.